And if anyone is trying to join, I think now the Zoom is full. So you can just share the YouTube link. I already shared it on my LinkedIn account. So you can go ahead and grab it from there. So without further ado, and let's not waste any more time and start today's webinar. So two things I need from you. You need to confirm that my voice is audible. Plus, you're seeing a screen where there's a Python logo and well, basically the PowerPoint slides. Yes, very good. Okay, thank you so much. Okay. So since everyone is, since we are all on the same page and the audio is good and you're seeing the slides, so let's start talking about Python, oil and gas, and how it utilizes Python for oil and gas and basically everything in between. So today is the first day of two-day webinar series where me and Petroleum Engineers Association are conducting. And in this two-day webinar, you will actually will gain some insights on the utilization of Python for oil and gas, plus how it's being used like in real case or in real life examples or real life cases within oil and gas companies or corporations and whatsoever. So Python actually is not a new language. It's been there from the 90s. However, it got lots of attraction after the 2000s, because in the 2000s, something very great happened to Python, which was the addition of third-party libraries that actually accelerated the growth of the language. For older people who are like having like some experience with programming, I'm sure they heard about like languages like C++ or C or even like C# or like Pascal or like older languages. However, most people have not heard of Python until the mid of the 2000s, because until the mid 2000s, Python was just a regular programming language. It was just general purpose, and actually it did not offer like a lot of features. But now everything have changed like for the past 15 years. So let me just give you a glimpse of what Python can be used nowadays. Python now is being used for web development. It's used to develop softwares on the desktop side. I will give you a very popular example of which software that's a commercial software in oil and gas industry that's developed using Python, which is a software called TechLog by Schlumberger. This software is a petrophysical tool that's used to analyze logs and formation evaluation and stuff like this. So it's built 100% on Python. And in current days, most companies who offer like commercial software, they are shifting towards integration with Python, because Python is very easy to learn. And a lot of people just picking up Python because of its ease of use. Lots of people using Python for mathematical calculations, for engineering calculations. Some people even go further and use it for system scripting. System scripting is basically when you tell Windows which tasks to perform at which time. So this is like a part of automation. And majority of people use Python for data science. This data science basically sets of knowledges and science and theory behind analyzing data, putting the data into the proper shape, driving insights, and driving all of these nifty knowledges from the data. So basically, Python is very popular currently for these types of users. Plus, in the recent years, Python is being used for engineering design, like CAD designs and CFDs and things like this. So let's take a look. Why have Python gained this attraction? For example, if we compare Python to other programming languages, we see that Python has a really large number of libraries. So I will give you an example of what does that mean. So let me just launch my web browser, and you should go to a website called PyPy. So basically, the PyPy website is actually, this is the main website where you go ahead and download Python libraries. So each and every library that's official, or sometimes it's even not official, you can find in this website. For example, you can see there is more than 450,000 active projects. True, these do not all translate to libraries, but however, you can see like how many active projects are currently existing on Python. And plus, there is a big community for Python. A community basically is like the user base for a specific programming language. The bigger the community, the better, because the more the problem you have, like with a specific programming language, you need to ask like a more senior people or a people with more knowledge in that language. For example, if you are having a problem with deploying like a specific feature in Python, you can just go ahead and simply ask on the internet. You will find thousands of answers. So this is the benefit of having a big community. Plus, there is a huge support from the founders of the Python itself. We are getting constant updates and constant features are being added to Python, which is a very good thing. And by the way, most programming languages, they stopped doing this. So you will like for some programming languages like Pascal and Basic, there is actually zero. Yeah, and even Fortran, there is zero updates for these languages these days. Plus, one of the most important things and one of the things that I love in Python is actually you can share the code. What does the meaning of the share the code? If you have like a strong knowledge in computer, you will understand this right away. But let me just break it down for you. Assume that you have multiple computers in your work system or in your house. Some of these computers, they can have like different operating system. For example, you might have a specific computer that it's working on Windows 7 and another one working in Windows 10. Maybe you'll have another laptop which is working on Linux. Maybe you'll have a MacBook. So these are all different operating systems. Some programming languages, actually, they are designed to work on specific system. Python is not like this. Python actually is designed to work everywhere. Even on iOS, like iPhone or iPad, it can work on Android. It will work definitely on Linux. It works on web-based applications. Python actually is everywhere. You cannot emphasize enough on the importance of this subject. So Python basically is everywhere. You can now go ahead, if you have an Android tablet or you have an iPad, you can go ahead and download Python and you can write the same code that's written on the Windows desktop. It will be 100% the same without any modification. Plus, why do we teach or why do we actually emphasize on Python for oil and gas? Basically, because Python offers a good number of libraries that are dedicated specially for oil and gas industry. So we will take a look at a couple of these libraries in today and tomorrow. So let me just give you an example of what Python looks like. We will go ahead and launch the editor as well. So we can type few codes, but let me just compare Python to other programming languages. For example, there is a very common comparison between Python and C Sharp. Basically, C Sharp, C++, C, they all look the same. If you take a look at the at the bottom of the slide where this table exists, the left-hand side of the table says Python and the right-hand side says C Sharp. So if you take a look at the Python side, you will see Python can print like any word or like any value just using a single line, which is print hello world. While in C Sharp, you have to do all of these crazy imports. You have to do like all of these crazy classes and things like this until you will reach to the line where it says console write line, which is the actual printing line. I am not saying C Sharp is bad. Actually, I have been in the past 5 years, I have been a active C Sharp developer. Plus, I was a professional in C Sharp. But nowadays, I only use Python because it's very easy and it's very simple. And let me just give you the honest truth. Python actually is free. 99% of the libraries are free. So you can just kickstart your project or kickstart anything you want for $0. So that's very important for everyone. Python comes in various packages. You have a few packages to select from. For example, the main packages that Python comes in. It's the IDLE or the main package you will download from the Python website, which is the python.org, which is something I do not recommend. This is basically it's lacking like all the crazy features of the Python. Plus, it does not contain any libraries except for the core or the standard library in Python. So there is an alternative to this is using a prepackaged Python, which is called Anaconda. Anaconda actually is a package or like, let's say like it's a container that contains Python. Some IDEs or some programs that we use to write code, plus all of the hundreds of libraries that comes with Python. So you have everything like inside a container, so you do not need to go ahead and install everything separately. So I would highly recommend to you go ahead and download Anaconda if you're trying to work with Python. Anaconda you can find easily online by searching for Anaconda in Google. So you go ahead and write Anaconda download. By the way, Anaconda download is free. It's free of charge. You can go ahead today and grab it. It will contain everything that you need to start working with Python. And by the nature of Anaconda, Anaconda comes packaged with multiple softwares that you can use to write Python. For example, it comes with a software called Spider. Spider is just a IDE or integrated development environment where you use to write code and execute that code. If you do not want to use a Spider, there's another thing called JavaScript Lab. This is used to basically prototype code. Plus, if you do not like both of these, you can use something else called Visual Studio Code. This is a software by Microsoft. It's free, it's open source. And most companies that strictly apply IT policies in oil and gas industry, they approve of this application because it's open source. So you can go ahead and download that in addition to Anaconda. So basically you have to have Anaconda. And once you have Anaconda, you can go ahead and install all of these crazy libraries or all of these software that you want to do. This is the download link for the Anaconda. Now, let's see which companies or which softwares now started shifting towards Python. Now we're talking about like commercial softwares in oil and gas industry. So the first and the foremost software that relies 100% on Python is the TechLog, which is offered by Schlumberger. You have another software called Olga. Olga is now is a dynamic production simulator that's it's now integrating its workflows with the Python. So you can use Python to drive calculations or to drive the software itself from the code. How cool is that? Pipesim in 2017, like 6 years before, it started shifted. It shifted its efforts from Fortran to Python. Now you can use Python in order to create well models, well files, and things like this. By the way, you need to a commercial license to do this. However, the Python side is free. However, you need to a commercial license to use Python Pipesim. Sorry. And there is a Python library for petroleum experts package as well. Petroleum expert basically is the provider of Prosper, Gap, MBAL, and softwares on the same caliber. You have the geolog of the paradigm. It's relying on the Python as well, or you can have like Python integration as well. By the way, paradigm now is not existing anymore. Geolog or the paradigm package is now under Aspen Tech software. So Aspen actually acquired Paradigm. Plus you have the T-Navigator, which is like a very popular reservoir simulator. It has like this great integrability with, it has this great integration with Python. So basically these are all the softwares that you can use in conjunction with Python. You can use Python to create a lot of things. For example, I give you like a very basic example. You can use actually Python to create a virtual production system. This is what I will show you in like a couple of minutes. Basically, you have all of these equations that's already existing in Python. You can connect all this production data to Python, and then you can drive well performance or reservoir performance from Python. Plus you can combine Python with data servers. So you can pull data directly from databases like SQL and like even NoSQL databases, you can just connect to Python very easily under two or three lines of code. You can do all of these crazy integrations with Python, for example. If you have softwares like Olga, Paradigm, Pipesim, and Petroleum Expert Solutions that's relying around in your company, what you can do actually is you can connect these softwares to SQL servers. By the way, by default, these softwares do not connect to SQL server. How you can do that? You can do that using Python. You can take all of these updated values from the database server, and then you will put these data inside these commercial softwares. Once you do that, you can use Python to launch these softwares and run the simulation, plus collect the data. Once you do that, you collect the data, you can present them in a useful report. So this will actually eliminate the process to go through the files manually. You can just write a script that reads hundreds of files for you and summarizes everything for you, like in a simple report. That can be done only using Python or something that's similar to Python that can integrate with all of these softwares. Basically, Python is the main software to do this. You can have like lots of solutions. Basically, this is the solution that we talked about. And let me just show you which libraries that we usually use in Python that are specific to oil and gas. By the way, the list of this library is like, I compiled like months ago. I think this is outdated now because lots of libraries have been added since. So I need to update this table as well. So the first and the foremost library that we usually use for oil and gas is a library called Lasio. Lasio is basically used to open the LAS and the LIS files. This will be very helpful to create like log file calculations, calculate the porosity and the permeability and the cross plot. This is all inside Python and it's out of course. So you do not need to pay $0 for this. So this is free. All the libraries are free, by the way. And you have another library called Fluids. Fluids basically is a multi-phase flow calculation library. You can use it to identify flow patterns. You can use it to calculate like different parameters for multi-phase flow equations. You have another library, which is one of the libraries I love very much, which is called PZAPI. This library is used to build vertical flow performance correlations. And actually, it does not stop there. You can integrate it with reservoir models. You can integrate it with databases. So you can have all of these updated vertical lift calculations. You can export VLP tables. You can do actually lots of things with it. So the project I will show you in just a few minutes, it's built on this library. You have another library called WellPath. This is used to create 3D well paths, plus you can visualize it. So you can have like all of these calculations algorithm that's already built in this library. So you can utilize it to create like a well path for drilling engineering or something like this. You have another library called CoolProp. This is basically, it was not a Python library. It was converted to a Python library. This is, by the way, it's a very famous library. It's used to create PVT properties. You can use it to create equation of state calculations. You can use it to calculate critical temperature, critical pressure, bubble point, dew point, basically any property you want, you can use to calculate this. Plus it accepts the use of compositions like methane, ethane, propane, butane with any percentage that you like. So basically, these are all those libraries that exist out there. By the way, there are like tens of more of libraries that I have not included for the shortness of the time. Now we have to take a look at the libraries that are specific to oil and gas. Now let's take a look at the libraries that are more in general and everyone is using. For example, the first and foremost library is the Pandas. Pandas is a huge library in Python. It's used to handle tabulated data. For example, if you have data that's lying in Excel sheets, you can use this to open the data, search for specific value. Maybe you can't plot everything in Python. So the limits are the sky. So you can do lots and lots of things with this library. So let me just show you the Pandas library. Let me just show you the basic or the main website for the Pandas library. You can just go ahead to the PyPy and type Pandas. You will see this library there. So this is not the full story. If you go ahead and scroll down a little bit, it shows you like how to use the library, how to download it, which versions of Python does it support, and all of these things. Plus, on the top, it shows you like the latest release for this library. You can see the latest release is the 24th of April. So this was like just like 10 days ago. So like the most latest release. You can see like how many downloads. For example, you can see this library had 111 million downloads only this month. So you can see how huge this library is. Plus it has like this great user base. So actually I use it almost on a daily basis. This is very important library. Basically think of this library as an Excel sheet for Python. It's very useful library, by the way. You have another library which is called NumPy. This is used to perform like mathematical calculations on vectors and matrices. It's useful as well. You have another library which is one of the OG libraries in Python. It's called Matplotlib. This is basically used for plotting purposes. You have another library, which is called Dash. Dash basically is relatively a new library. This is used to create dashboards and web-based interfaces for Python. It's a very cool library. You have Plotly. Plotly is one of the best plotting libraries you can find in Python. It's interactive. It's beautiful. The plus, there is a huge support for it, and it's free. Now we have a library that's very dear to my heart. It's called Streamlit. Streamlit basically is taking the Python World Biomestorm. It's used to create the graphical user interface for Python. However, there is a trick in this. Whenever you create the user interface that you create and launch, actually you can share the interface with other people that are sitting on the same network with you. Meaning that the link that you provide to your interface, actually everyone else with the same link that can access the software that you created or the interface that you created, so they can have it and they can utilize it. You will have the full control on this. However, other people can use it as well. Plus, we have other libraries like scikit-learn. This is used for machine learning. You have like SPICY, which is SciPy. You have the other Python, other libraries like PyXL, which is used to control Excel softwares. So now let's move to the coding part, which is, I think, everyone is waiting for. Let me just, before doing anything, let me just create a new Python file. Do not be overwhelmed with the software once you participate in the training, and you will get properly trained how to use the software and all the file types. So let me just call it calc, like calculation. Now you will have like this prompt. You can just type anything in this prompt. For example, let's create a simple equation that adds two volumes together. For example, let's create a variable called oil production like this, and then let's assign a value to it. For example, let's say the value of oil production is 1,000. Let's create another variable called water production. Let's assign a value to it, like, for example, like 750 or something like this. Now, if we want to create a calculation between these two variables, or the calculation between variables in Python, it's known as expression. So let's create this expression or this calculation. So we will call it liquid rate or liquid production to keep everything persistent. So it will be oil production plus the water production, and that's it. If you want to view the values, you will use something called print. Print is used to view just the calculation value, something like this. So liquid production, and you will click on this run button, and you will get the values or the results in just a minute. Python is connecting to the, by the way, this is just a first time thing. Whenever you create a new file in Python, Python is just connecting to the Python server on your machine. And once the connection is finished, you will get the results you want. There we go. Now we have our results, which is 1750. So if you want to create like other calculations, for example, let's create another variable called water oil ratio. WOR. So basically, this is just what the name implies. It's water divided to the oil. So water production divided by oil production. So let's go ahead and print the results. By the way, you can print the results by passing the value that you want. Plus, you can provide a message as well. So this message will be helpful for the user that's the viewing the results. For example, water oil ratio equals to like a specific value. You can go ahead and just click run. There we go. Now we have our results. Water oil ratio is 0.75. This is basic glimpse on how Python code is written. I am sure that you have noticed it's very simple to write Python codes, and it's very intuitive, and it's very similar to the English language. Now let's move to the a more complex or more complicated project. I have prepared a project for you guys, so you can see this is one of the things that we have. We teach our students or our participants how to do in Python, which is known as nodal analysis optimizer or nodal analysis optimization. So basically, what is this? Let me just give you an idea. Basically, nodal analysis is one of the well-known techniques in oil and gas industries, specifically people who are working in reservoir and production area. So basically what you have, you only have typically wells that you are uncertain of this, their performance, plus there is a lot of variables going on in the performance of the well. So if maybe you want to evaluate the performance of the well, maybe you want to design like new wells and you want to see what the production will be like. Your bet is usually to use a commercial software like Pipesim, Prosper, Wellflow, any other software that provides this caliber of services. Luckily, now you don't need to use these commercial softwares. I am not saying you have not, you don't need to use them. Actually, you can use them. However, some companies, they do not have the enough budget to buy these types of softwares. So what you can do, actually, you can use Python to create the solution. So what you will do, you can create the IPR, the VLP, the fluid properties, the flow maps. They actually can even create an interactivity while designing your well. So let me just show you the solution I have built. This is, by the way, this is the solution I built. It's only under 200 lines of code. So you can imagine all of these features that I have added. It's only 200 lines of code, even less than that. You have basically this application. This is a local application that's running on my machine. You can see this is the address to it. And so you have three different tabs. So the first tab, actually, you have all of these variables that are plotted with depth. For example, you have the pressure distribution with depth, which is the first chart. You have the temperature distribution with depth. You have plus the actual nodal analysis. By the way, these charts are interactive. You can zoom them. You can take snapshot for them. You can deactivate one of these curves. You can just do whatever you like with this chart. The most important part of this type of application is the nodal analysis optimizer. Nodal analysis optimizer is the well performance on steroid. For example, you can change the GOR by just sliding this one. The slider, it calculates the well performance based on the new GOR that you have created. For example, you can see the more the GR you have, the more the production you'll have. For example, you want to predict the well performance at a specific wellhead. For example, the base wellhead is 350 PSI. So you can change this to like 1,600 PSI so you can see what will happen to the well. For example, let's crank it up to 2,600. You can see at 2600, now the production is starting to stall, meaning that you are actually getting to a specific point where there is no intersection between these two curves. Whenever you do not have any intersection, actually meaning that the well will die off and it will not produce. So you can have all of these scenarios. And everything, by the way, everything you see is interactive. And plus, it's built inside Python. And one of the useful things that we usually do is actually we need to take a look with depth. What's the flow patterns that are occurring? Do we have any slug flow? Do we have any bubbles of gas occurring? You can do that as well in Python. For example, I have prepared this table. By the way, this table is calculated and it's affected with whatever value of these sliders I add in here. So you can go to flow map. You can see at each depth increment, what's the type of the flow that's happening. For example, you can see everything is distributed flow, and I have attached this image for your reference of different flow types. So let me show you the code that is doing everything. So I have created a file called nodal analysis dashboard. Basically, nodal analysis dashboard, that the file I have created is pulling data from, or it's pulling features from all of these imports. It's pulling feature from NumPy. It's pulling feature from a library or a class called BigXumbrel, which is basically what we used to create the solution. I am using Streamlit, which is the thing I love very much. Streamlit is what actually is what's enabling me to create all of these buttons and all of these graphical user interfaces. Plus you have the Plotly, which is creating all of these interactive charts. Plus I am using Pandas in case I need to like deal with tabulated data. Plus you have all of these inputs that we used to create this calculation. For example, you have the oil rate, the water rate, the GOR, the all of these inputs that are necessary to create such a calculation. You can see we have few methods, few calculations that we are calculating the temperature gradient, the depth gradient, and things like this, plus how we are calculating all of these things. Plus, at the bottom of the application, you will find all of these things that we are creating, the titles, the tabs, the columns, all of these different charts and things like this. You can see there are spaces between the codes. However, you can see the application is just 162 lines. You can add like lots of features to this application. Let me just show you one thing. What if the user wants to change the API gravity of the oil? The API gravity of the oil, actually, it's not exposed in the application that you see in here. Actually, to be honest, 100%, it's exposed. However, it's hidden. You'll go ahead and click on this button. You will see something called API. You can just go ahead and change the API to 35. Or any value you want, just press on enter. Once you press on the enter, the software will update itself. So you do not need to like press the calculate button or anything. For example, let's change the API to like 19 and press enter as well. You can see all of these values are already updated. By the way, if you want to expose more features or like more variables that you need to include for the user so he can update on the real time. What you can do is, let's expose actually the tubing head pressure, or let's expose the tubing head temperature just real fast. So I will copy this one. I will call it tubing head temperature so the user can have access to it so he can change it whatever he likes. So tubing head temperature, by the way, you can have the label whatever you like. Now we have those controls. Those controls, the minimum value and the maximum value, these will be used for the validation purpose. So meaning that the user cannot go below 9 and he cannot go above 150. And the value will be tubing head temperature, which is the value I am pulling from line number 17. So let's save everything. Once you save everything, using the Control and S button on your keyboard, the application will be updating itself, believe it or not. So we are having a few slight issue in here. So let's go ahead and fix it. Tubing head temperature. Yeah, so we're having some issues in here, but this is basically the basic idea. You can expose whatever you like. For example, you can change the labels and things like this, and the user can have the access to whatever you provide for him. So let me just save this so everything goes back to normal. Now, actually we have a few minutes left before we conclude today's webinar, but let me show you something that's very interesting. I will just stop broadcasting from my laptop and I will convert to my Android tablet. Let me just share my Android screen. Now, the Android screen should be visible for everyone. If yes, please say so. Now you should be seeing like a Google thing that's showing on. By the way, this is just a regular Redmi tab. So if I want to view the application that I have created using my Python, in my tablet, it's very easy to do. The only thing I need to do is actually, I need to provide the link to the application itself. So let me just pull up the link. So the link will be actually based on your local IP, which is in my case is 192.168.0.55. By the way, 0.55, which is the my laptop IP. Do not worry, I will change the IP once this webinar finishes. Plus, you need to include the column, and then there is a number post for the column, which is actually the port number of the application. So once you click enter, now you can see it's loading. Just wait for a few seconds. Now you can see the same application that you have just saw on my computer. Now it's on my tablet. By the way, I can interact with it. I am just touching the screen. I can change those slider values by touching the screen. You can see everything's updated. I can zoom on the chart. Plus, I can download it as an image. You can see it's already downloaded as an image. So I will go ahead and open it. Now you can see the image is now on my Android tablet. You can go ahead and change all of these functions that we have explored. For example, the API 35, we can go ahead and change it to API 19. You can see everything is changing in the interface. You can see the application is loading. And yeah, you can go ahead and change the settings. For example, you can go ahead and change the background from light to dark. And by the way, anything that you do, any change you are doing on the application, this will not reflect on the main application that you have created. This is only a local version of the application that you are viewing on your tablet or your Android or even on your iPad. So this is basically the flow map. Now, hopefully you have seen what you like. Now let's go ahead and move to the next application, which is going to be the analyzing of gas wells using Python. By the way, analyzing gas wells using Python is it's very simpler than you think. For example, I am creating a software that is analyzing the performance of the gas wells in under like 40 lines of code or 35 lines of code. So let me just launch the application or launch the liquid loading application. So you only need to include one line, which is Streamlit run, the name of the application, which is turner.py. Do not get overwhelmed with this. If you participate in our training, you will learn all of these and some more. Now you should see a new application is being launched. This application, what I am doing in this application, actually there is an Excel sheet that's connected to this application. This Excel sheet actually contains more than 50 gas wells to be precise. And it's loading the data into application. And then we will be using these data in order to create calculations. Just wait for everything to load. You can see the view is not very pleasant. What you can do is just go to settings and convert it to white mode. Everything will just fall in place. On the left-hand side, you have all those wells you can select from. For example, I will select the Lark lease or the Lark well. You can see all the results are being updated. On the bottom, you have three charts, which are basically used to analyze the liquid loading. For example, the region, which is in red. By the way, the red region is already a calculated region. So the plots, I am changing the color of this portion of the plot intentionally. This portion meaning that you have some liquids that are accumulated in the gas well. Plus, we are comparing the liquid production. For example, we have the oil production in the orange and you have the water production in blue. We are comparing those as well with time. Plus, you have the wellhead pressure with time. Plus you have the main plot, which is the turnover rate and the gas rate. You can see some wells will have liquid loading that's being happening in the well. For example, let's switch to another well. You can see the minute you switch to another well, the instant response you will get from the application itself, because it's filtering and loading the data on the background. So you do not have to do anything. It's doing this thing for you. For example, you can do like, you can add like more charts. You can just view the data behind this application. For example, let's go ahead and in this empty region on the bottom, we will add the data that's being displayed. So I will do something. So st.data frame, this will be used to plot the table. That's the reason these plots are showing. So the data is existing in something called gas data. So let's save everything. Once we save this, we will go back to our application. Now it says that the source file have changed. What do you want to do? Meaning that there is a change in our application. So we need to rerun this application so everything is reflected. Now you can see there is a table now showing on the bottom of the page, which did not exist before. This table actually is the data for the raw values. You can see I have viewed this element of the application in only single line. So you can see how Python can be a benefit to everyone in oil and gas companies, and not just in oil and gas companies and oil and gas industry. And it's beneficiary to everyone in all the industries. The beautiful thing about Python is very universal. It's very good to learn. Plus Python, you will need to learn it only one time. That one time you will learn it in a good manner, then you can apply it in multiple industries and it will live for you. It will live with you forever. So we will conclude today's session. So here, hopefully we will meet you tomorrow so I can show you more use cases that are just interesting as this one. So this is all from my end. So thanks, Nakheel. Thanks everyone for attending. Please, if you do have any questions, you can just drop it in the YouTube. I am just watching the YouTube channel as well, or you can just drop it in the chat box. If you like what you see, just share your thoughts. So thank you so much for attending. So hope.